Now, there's one tool that it's absolutely clear works. And it's always worked, it works now, and it will work forever. And that's repetition. The more often that you perform something or that you recite something, the more likely you are to remember it in the future. And while that might seem obvious, it's worth thinking about what's happening when you repeat something. What's happening is that you're encouraging the firing of particular chains of neurons that reside in a particular circuit, right? So a particular sequence of neurons playing neuron A, B, C, D, played in that particular sequence over and over and over again. And with more repetitions, you get more strengthening of those nerve connections. James McGaw and Larry Cahill did a number of experiments over several decades, really, that really established what's required to get better at remembering things and to do so very quickly. I want to talk about one experiment that they did that was particularly important. What they did is they had human subjects come into the laboratory and to read a short paragraph of about 12 sentences. And the key thing is that some subjects read a paragraph that was pretty mundane. Maybe it would be a story about someone who walked into a room, sat down at a desk, wrote for a little bit, then got up and had lunch. You know, just kind of mundane information, not very interesting. Another group of subjects read also a 12-sentence paragraph, but that paragraph included a subset of sentences that had a lot of emotionally intense language. So it might have talked about a car accident or a very intense surgery, but it also could be positive stuff. Subjects left the laboratory, and sometime later they were called back to the laboratory, and I should say, at no point in the experiment did they know they were part of a memory experiment. Okay? They don't know why they're reading this paragraph. They come back into the lab, and they would get a pop quiz. They would be asked to recall the content of the paragraph that they had read previously. The subjects that read the emotionally intense paragraph remembered far more of the content of that paragraph and were far more accurate in their remembering of that information. My typical mode of trying to learn something while I was in college or while I was in graduate school, as a junior professor, or tenured professor, was to sit down to whatever it is I was going to try and learn, perhaps even memorize, or if it was a physical skill, move to whatever environment I was going to learn that physical skill in. And prior to that, to make sure that I was hydrated, because that's important to me and certainly can contribute to your brain's ability to function and your body's ability to function and general patterns of alertness, but also to caffeinate. I would have a nice strong cup of coffee or espresso. I would have a nice strong cup of yerba mate. So caffeine really hits these three systems. It hits other systems too, but it mainly reduces fatigue by reducing adenosine, increases alertness by increasing epinephrine release or adrenaline release, I should say, both from the adrenals in your body and from locus coeruleus within the brain. And it can, in parallel to all that, increase the action or the efficacy of the action of dopamine. So my typical way of approaching learning and memory would be to drink some caffeine and then focus really hard on whatever it is that I'm trying to learn, try and eliminate distractions, and then hope, or try to remember that information as best as I could. If people take photos of a scene or a person or an object, that they are actually less good at remembering the details of that scene or object, etc. This study challenged that idea and raised the hypothesis that if people are allowed to choose what they take photos of, that taking photos, again, this is with a camera, not mental snapshotting, that taking those photos would actually enhance their memory for those objects, those places, those people, and in fact, details of those object, places, and people. It means if you really want to remember something or somebody, take a photo of that thing or person, pay attention while you take the photo, but it doesn't really matter if you look at the photo again. Somehow the process of taking that photo, probably looking at it, you know, in a camera, typically we'd say through the viewfinder, or now because of digital cameras on the screen on the back of that camera or on your phone, that framing up of the photograph stamps down a visual image in your mind that is more robust at serving a memory than had you just looked at that thing with your own eyes.